Without salmon, I would feel like there's an empty hole in my heart. I really think that our world as we know it would cease to exist.
Pacific Rim National Park Reserve is made up of a network of small stream systems. Historically, these small streams were very productive. They supported healthy populations of wild Pacific salmon. Close to 30% of the park was logged prior to the land being set aside for national park purposes. This logging severely impacted healthy stream habitats and caused the salmon to almost disappear. Parks Canada, along with local First Nations and Central West Coast Forest Society, are working to restore these streams and bring salmon back to the park.
Just before the park was established, about a quarter of this area was logged. In those years, often creeks were logged to the bank, so there wasn't even a buffer left around those creeks. So with the trees removed and the extensive rainfall that we get here, a lot of debris, sediment, and everything that should not be in the creek ended up in the creek.
And this caused the stream to not flow properly. It caused sediment to back up. Fish could no longer access because they couldn't get through these debris jams, and the sediment sort of infilled and buried the natural spawning gravels.
When salmon declines, all the other things in response, they decline as well. For example, bears rely on salmon in order to acquire fat reserves to hibernate. If salmon runs fail, bears suffer.
Pacific salmon are unique in their life history compared to other fish species because they rely on both freshwater and marine systems to complete their life cycle. Young salmon start out their life in the freshwater creeks, and they'll spend a short time in these creeks until they make their migration into the ocean. In the marine environment, in the oceans, they're able to feed on rich marine foods and basically pack it on. They get bigger, faster than they could ever get in the freshwater creeks. And after 2 to 4 years, they're able to come back to their natal streams. And they're able to do this by a process called chemoreception, which basically means they smell their way back to those creeks. And in these creeks, that's where the adults are going to spawn and give birth to the new young of the next generation.
Once they spawn, they die, and they become a great protein source for dozens of different species. And the bears and eagles and seagulls will pack the morts, the dead fish, way up into the forest and actually fertilize the forest.
So in essence, you could say that salmon accessing and spawning in those streams, they feed the trees that grow on stream banks. So that's why those trees grow the largest. They actually have salmon in them.
And, you know, as the people on the West Coast here have the saying, Hishuk is tawak. Everything is one, or everything is connected. And so it's important that we all understand that.
The Pacific Rim has been established to protect a piece of temperate rainforest, and salmon-bearing streams are a key feature of such a forest. Overall, the degradation of this area as a salmon-producing environment have been considerable, and so any restoration that we can afford surely helps to revert that trend and that condition.
Like, there was tons of salmon here, every kind of salmon. Like, right from coho to sockeye. There was really lots. There was more than enough to go around. But we also only took what we needed, never more, never less.
You know, the people have been here for thousands of years, and we're not newcomers to this part of the world, so people did have an intimate knowledge of all these areas, you know. And those songs and those dances that our people do have, they're basically teachings about natural law. And, you know, we all live under natural law, that we're not allowed to just go there and take and you know, not be aware of the consequences.
We're hoping to restore this area by bringing back the habitat required to support healthy salmon populations. And we do that by repositioning and removing some of the large and small woody debris that was dumped into these creeks, and placing this large woody debris to provide certain habitat features that are required by salmon. We also add spawning gravel to improve the spawning grounds. We plant streamside vegetation and trees to help restore the vegetation on the bank so they will provide shade and cover for the salmon in the streams and help regulate water temperatures.
One key thing that we look for are barriers. Sometimes there's a real bad culvert that's put in. Some of them we call hung culverts because the drop out of the culvert is higher than what a fish can jump to get to the upstream. By replacing one culvert on Sandhill Creek, we opened up 18 kilometers of habitat.
Through our monitoring efforts, we've been able to measure a great number of successes where we're seeing individual rocks that have been placed in the stream being used by salmon as cover, or we've seen logs placed into the stream scour deep pools. Then we're seeing rearing salmon grow in these pools. We're seeing wild Pacific salmon return to their natal streams, habitat that was previously inaccessible.
It's amazing. These animals will go through a gauntlet of different predators and barriers just to come back to the streams. And if we here in the park can ensure that we have the stream that is healthy and has the spawning gravel and has the habitat for the young fish, it's really, if we can give at least them that peace, we know we're doing our part.
And the forest for the whole world is a very important thing. It's, you know, like our lungs of the world. If we don't restore it, you know, we're going to be in big trouble on this planet.
What my hopes for the future are is that we can establish a healthy ecosystem so that my great-grandchildren can enjoy the same things that I do.